Welcome class. My name is Mr. Maswa. I'm going to take you through the 13th lesson. And today we are going to focus on organizational charts. Now remember we were saying in our previous lesson that in an organization there must be flow of information from one level of leadership to another. So this is organized in what we call an organizational chart. Now, this is our objective for this lesson. So we expect by the end of the lesson, you will be expected to identify various organizational structures in different business organizations. Now, what are the benefits of having an organizational chart? For one, it shows how everybody is linked together in the organization. They know who to reach and how. So if you have a chart, so everyone knows how he or she is related to the other, who is above them, who is below them, whom they are supposed to reach to in case of anything, and how they are going. Importance of our chart is that each employee can also see their own position, alright, whose authority they are under and who they have authority over. So in an organizational chart you are able to tell who is below you, who is above you, whom do you have authority over and who is having authority over you. But three, it gives everyone a sense of belonging. It motivates them to move up the chain of command. For example, if you are a supervisor, okay, it motivates you to move to the next step so that you have more people under your command. There are two types of organizational structures for business. As we look here, this is the first one. So, the first type of an organizational structure is where we have a tall structure with a long chain of command. As you can see here, we have the topmost leader, who will be the CEO, occupying that post. Under him, we have two who could be directors. Then under them, we have these four, two here. Then this one again, there are two. Then it goes on like that. So we are saying, this one is a tall structure. From this person up to this group of people. It's a very long chain of command. And we look at the disadvantages and advantages of having such a long chain of command. Meaning information will take long before it reaches the person down there. Number two, another type of organizational structure or chart is where we have a wide structure with a short chain of command. Right? This one here, you see, is a short chain of command, but it is wide. So as you can see, we have the CEO here, then there's another three leadership position, then we have this one, and finally this one. So we are saying it is short. So information flows very fast. But again, it is very wide. It is a short, wide structure. Now, we shall look at several definitions of terms that we have been using here. The first term we are looking at is what we call a chain of command. What is a chain of command? Now, the structure in a business that allows instructions to be passed down from a person another, he loved them in their command. This is what we call a chain of instruction that allows instructions to be passed down from a person to another, he loved them in a chain of command. For example, I'll give you an example of a school situation. How does information, what is the chain of command? Number one, we have the board of management. These are the owners, the proprietors of the school. They are not teachers. They hold no administrative position in the school. But they are the ones who contributed capital to start the school. They are the board. Then we have the principal. Right? So if the board has some message that they want to communicate to parents or to the students, they cannot do it directly. No. So they communicate to the principal. Then the principal communicates to the headmasters or the Tafin, primary, secondary, and university. Then the headmaster communicates to the deputy headmaster. The deputy headmaster communicates to the senior teachers. The senior teacher communicates to the class teachers. The class teacher can communicate to the prefect. Then the prefect communicates to the whole class. That is a chain of command. Now, it is downward, then it is also upward. The same information can be passed from the student or the parent through the student, the prefect, the class teacher, to the senior teacher, and so on up to the top level. That is what we call a chain of command. The second term we want to discuss is what we call subordinate. And who is a subordinate? This is someone who is lower in rank under authority of a superior manager. This is someone lower in rank. So like, I am the teacher, the prefect is subordinate. They are lower in rank. The other term we look at is what we call a span of control, and this simply refers to how many subordinates work directly under a manager. How many people work directly under a manager? That is the span of control in the manager. Authority. This is someone that has recognized power to make decisions and to delegate tasks. Someone who has authority, who has power to make decisions and to delegate or issue tasks to the subordinates. We say his authority. The delegation refers to the process of giving authority for a subordinate to perform a task or instructions. To give authority for a subordinate. Now, what are the advantages of having a short and wide structure? Alright? This structure here. Short and wide. What advantages does it have? One, say communication is faster and more accurate. So the top managers are more in touch with the subordinates because there are less levels. Right? Another advantage is that there is wider span of control, which means employees feel more trusted and take more decisions by themselves. Now, in organizational charts, it is usually arranged in departments, e.g. finance department, operations department, marketing, information technology, and so on. That is how things are arranged. They are arranged according to departments. Now, sometimes there is a conflict between departments. That is, the marketing department, for example, wants to buy something, but the finance department does not think it is necessary. Alright? This is a conflict. So we have two. departments. We have the marketing department and the finance department. Now, the marketing department is supposed to look for market, supposed to look for customers. There are people in charge of sales, selling the products, right? The market. Then the finance department are the people who receive the money, and they are the ones who also give money to all these other departments. So, the marketing department, for example, wants to buy a van that will facilitate their movement in the market. Then the finance department feels it's not necessary. In case they need to travel, they can hire a van. This is a conflict between two departments. Now what happens? So the supervisors working in these departments are line managers, and they have direct responsibility over people below them in the organizational chart. Okay, these are line managers. Now we also have staff managers who are specialists in certain areas to provide support and information to the line managers. So these are also specialists in certain areas, and their work is to support the line managers. That brings us to the end of our first part of the lesson. In the next lesson, we are going to look at that